The debate over reopening schools amid the coronavirus is now in full swing. And some that have already reopened are really a preview of the challenges ahead. A 15-year-old student in Georgia says that she has been suspended from her school. Why? After posting a photo of a crowded hallway between classes. Hannah Waters put up the image you're seeing right now on Twitter. It shows kids who are jam-packed in the halls of North Paulding High School, and she says many were not wearing any masks. The Paulding County Superintendent sent a letter to the community saying the photo is really out of context, writing this: class changes at the high school level are a challenge when maintaining a specific schedule. It is an area we are continuing to work on in this new environment to find practicable ways to further limit students from congregating. Students are in this hallway environment for just a brief period as they move to their next class. He went on to say, there is no question that the photo does not look good and that wearing a mask is a personal choice, and there is no practical way to enforce a mandate to wear them. The student that took that picture, Hannah Waters, joins me now. Hannah, thank you for being here. And thank you for taking that photograph that we're able to see, because people don't have a real clear image of what's really happening in these schools right now. And so, Hannah, you know, you went to school. Of course, you saw the crowds in the halls. You saw there were a lot of masks. You took the picture. Hannah, why did you choose, or why did you want to post this image?
I took the photo initially after seeing the first day of school photo taken by someone else go online as well and got picked up by some media coverage, and I took it out of mostly concern and nervousness after seeing the first days of school.
So what were you so concerned and nervous about?
I was concerned for the safety of everyone in that building and everyone in the county, because precautions that the CDC and guidelines that the CDC has been telling us for months now weren't being followed.
And Hannah, what is shocking to a lot of people is that here you are, you're a sophomore now, right? And you've been suspended? And why? The school told you that you had violated the code of conduct for using your phone and posting to social media, but you say you didn't violate the rules. Why not?
I violated three of the code of conduct policies. One of them saying that I use my phone during instruction time and that I use it in the hallway during class change. But it also says that students 9 through 12 have permission to use it. The second one that they said I broke was using my phone during school hours for social media. But I posted the photo onto Twitter after school during dismissal, at the end of dismissal. And then the fourth one I did break. It was the one about filming students and posting it on social media platforms.
Do you regret doing any of this?
I'd like to say that this is some good and necessary trouble, so I don't regret posting this because it needed to be said.
Good trouble is a good thing, they say. CNN has also reached out to your school, by the way, Hannah, but we haven't heard back. But the superintendent did send out that message to families, and they said that the photo is just out of context and that students are only in the hallway for a really brief amount of time. Does that line up with what you've seen? Is it really that brief of an amount of time that these kids are passing, that your classmates and student body are passing each other like that?
We have about 5 minutes to go through class change. Some of us go from all the way in the front of the building to the second floor to the opposite side of the campus. So those 5 minutes we spend like speed walking all the way to class, and we pass so many people in the hallway. We pass people who are seniors, we pass freshmen, we pass teachers, we pass staff, we pass everyone in that building.
So have you seen a lot of cases of teens like yourself who are contracting or spreading the virus? I mean, what's your biggest fear if you got infected?
I've seen a few of my friends or fellow classmates that have told me or said online that they are being tested or that their family member has tested positive. So And obviously these types of things, you really, it takes a while to figure out if you've gotten it. So my biggest concern, it's not only about me being safe, it's about everyone being safe, because people behind every teacher, student, and staff member, there's a family, there's friends, and I would just want to keep everyone safe.
Sounds like you know precisely what good trouble is. Hannah Waters, thank you so much. Thank you for illuminating this and showing us what you were seeing, because we need to hear from you. Thank you.
Thank you as well.
Be safe. Thank you. You know, I want to bring in Arne Duncan now, former Secretary of Education in the Obama administration. Arne, I'm glad that you're here. Good evening to you. How are you?
Good evening. She's amazing. I don't want to follow her. There's nothing to add.
I was trying to give you a little bit of pause by asking how you were doing, because who wants to follow that? I know.
Remarkable. So proud of her.
What's also remarkable is that, you know, you heard from Hannah about what she's seeing there, but when you hear that the Paulding County superintendent, there's no way to enforce wearing a mask in schools, by the way, enforce a lot of things. I mean, she just read for you the things that she has been accused of violating and what you're supposed to do. I mean, is that a reasonable argument? They can't regulate masks?
I tweeted about it this morning. Everything about this is wrong. You know, first of all, schools have all kinds of rules and regulations, how you behave, how you act, what you can wear. To say that somehow you can't enforce this is ludicrous. To penalize her, suspend her for simply documenting very, very unsafe, unhealthy practices that clearly have not been thought through by the adults in charge there, they're putting everyone at risk. As she said, this isn't about her. She's worried about her teachers, about parents, mm-hmm. about grandparents. So nothing about this is adults leading with courage, you know, with honesty, with integrity, and thinking somehow you can silence young people today. That's beyond silly. You cannot silence young people. You got to listen to them. You have to pay attention to them. And when they're right and we as adults are wrong, you better step up and correct it very, very quickly. I'm stunned they suspended her. Stunned.
I mean, out of the mouths of babes and out of the lens of a camera, truth, right? I mean, you spoke at a congressional hearing about schools and you say the federal government is making the problem worse. How?
Well, it's just heartbreaking to me that here we are in August and we're debating, you know, can we go back to school safely? We all want children to return to physical schools, but across the country, many, many kids, maybe the majority, won't be able to do that, because as a nation, we haven't done in March and April and May and June and July what it took to beat down the virus in our communities that would enable us to open physical schools. And just the devastating lack of leadership from the current administration, not taking this seriously, same issue, fighting against people wearing masks, not listening to scientists, acting like this thing would just magically disappear. Just the tens of thousands of unnecessary deaths, the millions of people sick, the tens of millions of kids who will not be able to go back to physical school this fall, it's just absolutely heartbreaking to me.
And, you know, you are worried, as we all are and all should be, about the students, about the teachers. I mean, you talked about how the teachers, I mean, they aren't in a bubble. And so whatever they are exposed to in the schools, they'll be taking back out into the community. Tell me about your feelings on that.
Well, schools aren't islands. And we need to keep our children safe. We need to keep our teachers safe, our bus drivers, our custodians, our principals, our lunchroom attendants. And then our children don't live in a bubble either. They go home to parents, to grandparents. And so the only way to keep our schools safe or make them safe, one would be to have a massive investment from the federal government, which has not happened. I still hope it happens, but it's way, way late. But the biggest thing to make schools safe has nothing to do with the physical schools themselves. It has to do with reducing this virus, beating it down in the communities where we all live and where our children go to school. And our refusal to do that as a nation is absolutely devastating.